Move my mask.
Yeah, so we are at it's Olivier Puissot, and he will tell us about fast high fidelity qubit readout using cross curve coupling in CQED.
Yeah, so first of all, I would like to thank the organizer to let me the opportunity to present this experimental talk. And this work has been performed in Grenoble in our group. And it is mainly the work of two PhD students that I am going to present you today, the work of Rémi Dassonville and Vladimir Minshalkov. And this work has been made in a strong collaboration also on the theoretical part with Thomas Ramos and Juan José García Ripoll. But before starting on this subject, I would like only to flash you an interesting setup that we are starting to work, which is a completely different topic, but it's only one slide that I would like to show you. Yes. So we are starting also to work on a superconducting hybrid nanowire system based on germanium. And what it is interesting in my point of view in this system that we are starting in Grenoble is that we are able to work on a sample. You see that it's in completely monocrystalline structures where the aluminium, I don't see if you see here the atomic plane. So this is a transmission electronic microscope. So you see the atomic plane of aluminium. You see here the atom of germanium. And you see also the interface, which is completely flat here. And this is along, this is the direction of nanowires. And in this kind of system, it was the thesis of Jovian de la Force. We have performed some preliminary experiments, both in this germanium silicon core shell, where the physics were more driven by quantum conductance in nanowires, but also in a germanium, intrinsic germanium system, where we can control here the dot in some sense by up to the 20 nanometers. And here we see some transition from a single whole quantum dot system to a Josephson effect when we change the gate. So there is a lot of interesting things to do, and I would like only to mention this topic that I find very nice and rich in terms of physics. But today I would like to concentrate only on this quantum measurement system. And what I would like to present you is that typically this is a scenario to perform measurements. So you have artificial atoms or an atoms, and usually you are going to measure the quantum state of this system by applying some microwave photon inside the cavity, and by measuring the transmission, you would get information about the quantum states. But of course, this physics of measurements is driven by the microscopic coupling between the artificial atom and the cavity. And this is the interesting part that I would like to discuss more in detail today with you. So the standard coupling, I will be fast in this part, is what is called the transverse coupling, and this comes from an electrical interaction between the atoms and the cavity, and this produces the transverse coupling and the well-known Jens-Cummings Hamiltonians. And in this limit, when the qubit frequency is far detuned to the resonator, you can make a strong approximation, which is a dispersive limit, which is called dispersive limit. And in this case, the Hamiltonians start to be very nice for the readout because you have this approximate cross-pair coupling term, which are going to change the, change the frequency of the cavity depending on the qubit state. So this is the way that the people are measuring qubit in most of the superconducting qubit states. However, this is due to an approximation, and this produces lots of drawbacks in some sense in these measurements. First of all, the coupling strength of this cross-care is an optimization between a far detuning, but not too far, because if not, this parameter will be too weak. Also, an important thing that people do not insist enough, of course, here the qubit which is described in this Hamiltonian is no more the initial qubit. It's the qubit which is dressed by the photon states of a cavity. And this means that your qubit here, because of the stress of the photon states on the cavity, have some relaxation channel which produce the so-called Purcell effect or relaxations. And last point is this approximation is only valid when the photon number inside the resonator is small, and this is typically a limit that we don't want to do when we perform measurements because we want to have a large signal. So for these different reasons, we were thinking to find an alternative coupling which changed on the majority. So typically, all the people are working on this coupling that I showed you before, but since 10 years, typically, there was some suggestion to use a longitudinal coupling instead of a transverse. And this was a proposal of a group of, for example, Alexander Blay and in Sherbrooke, where they proposed this kind of coupling. And you see now the coupling is directly the coupling of the electric field of a cavity with sigma z of a qubit. And in our group, what we have proposed is to have a coupling which will be a cross-care, a non-perturbative cross-care, so it's not the same origin that what I just speak before. It's directly related to a specific microscopic design of a circuit which produces this kind of coupling. So I am going to speak about this last coupling, and I will show you the experimental results that we got in this coupling. So to obtain this coupling, we use a transmo molecule, and the transmo molecule is simply two transmons which are inductively coupled. So when you do that, you can easily demonstrate that the quantum dynamics in this simple circuit is given by two modes, a symmetric mode which will give you exactly the description of a transmon qubits, and there is an anti-symmetric mode which are going to be used for the readout. And what it is very important here is it's here which appear the coupling, is that the coupling between these two modes, so the qubit and the readout, is given by this product of cosinus. And if you do the expansion for small phase, in this case, you see that the coupling is given by this product terms, which give you directly a cross-care coupling, which is different origin than the dispersive cross-care coupling. And the interest of this cross-care coupling is the amplitude is no more dependent on problem of detuning, is related to the molecule parameters. And for example, you could have a very strong coupling in these terms. And also, now this derivation show that you have no more qubit, which is modified, dressed in some sense by the photon of the cavity. So it will have also impact on the relaxation process. So, of course, here I show you internal modes of a molecule. So, we could not really apply the measurements. To do that, we need to couple this internal mode of a readout to an external mode. And to realize that, we introduce our molecule inside the cavity, and we make an alignment in order to not break the symmetry, and in order that the electric field of the cavity will be transverse to the polarization of a qubit. By this way, we avoid any transverse coupling between the qubit and the cavity, and it will be aligned to the electric field of a readout mode. So by this way, we have a strong coupling. So this hybridization between the readout mode and the cavity will authorize to perform now really measurements because of this transverse coupling. So in the following, we are going to see what will be the property. And this is, in some sense, our motivation in Grenoble, is to understand this new kind of Hamiltonians, which describe a new kind of measurement system, which is different by the James Cummings-style Hamiltonian. So to perform the experiments, we need also to inject microwave inside the cavity. And we need to amplify this microwave, which is usually low signal. And for that, we use a Josephson parametric amplifier that has been developed in Grenoble in the group with Nicolas and Luca Plana. And so we are going to use this amplifier to perform our measurements. And typically, we are going to apply the readout frequency, which is in resonance to the cavity resonator when the qubit is in the excited state. So typically, we will have a large signal when the excited state, the qubit is in the excited state, and low signal when the qubit is in the ground state. So if you do measurements in this case, you obtain in the IQ plane the response of a microwave measurement when the qubit is ever in the G or E states. But to be more precise, we perform histogram here, where we prepare the qubit ever in the ground state, so it will be the blue curves. And in this case, you see that we have the Gaussians. The main Gaussian is centered to close to zero, so it corresponds to a low microwave amplitude signal. The width is related to the noise of the amplification chain. And we have some small excitations of the qubit showing the second Gaussians. And of course, we can prepare the qubit in the excited states. And in this case, we have a main Gaussian, which is at higher signal, because is the condition of our measurements. And we have a higher Gaussian showing the relaxation between the excited state to the ground state. So if we make the analysis of the error, we have a fidelity on this first generation readout of about 97%, which was quite good. And the main error was coming from the relaxation to the excited state to the ground state. So it was the end of the thesis of Rémy de Solville. And so Vladimir Michalkov decided to optimize the circuit parameter, keeping the same idea, but changing completely the sample. And he developed this new geometry, which was inspired by the group of Alexei Ustinov. And he used this cylindrical symmetry, in some sense, to reduce the residual transverse coupling between the qubit and the cavity. So in these new generations, you can see that, again, we can have this histogram analysis. But you see, for example, from the ground state now is mainly a single Gaussian, and you have only a residue of error here. And typically, it means that it's important to say that here, in this measurement, we perform, last in the previous one, pre-selection measurements. So we do two measurements, the first one to see what is the state of a qubit. And so, for example, for the ground states, we remove all the measurements who have shown that the ground state is, in fact, not in the ground state, but in the excited states. So it's a way to prepare or to select only the experiments where the qubit is in the ground state. So when we do that, we have an error which is very small, typically 0.1% of error of preparation on the ground state. And when we do the excited experiments, so we have this second Gaussians, which is have a lower second Gaussian because the relaxation time on this qubit was much more improved. It was typically 20 microseconds in this second sample. And so in this case, we got fidelity of readout, which is close to the state of the art of readout fidelity. And also, we were interested to probe the quantum non-demolition performance of a readout. So to do that, Vladimir has performed two successive readout measurements. So the first one is to initiate the qubit in the good state. So this is more for the preparation. But he performed two successive readouts, and he plots the results of the readout in this direction. And for the second readout, it is in this direction. So in some simple analysis, if the points are in the diagonal, it means that the two measurements are given the same results. So the measurement is not destroying the states. And if you have off diagonal, it means that you are starting to produce some destruction. Your measurement start to have some destruction on the qubit state. So you see, when the qubit is prepared on the ground state, then all the points are along the diagonal square. And when we are in the excited state, again, it's mainly in the diagonal. But you see here that there is much more points, indicating that in this case, that there is a small scenario that the qubit are prepared in the excited state. And before the second readout measurement, he has time to relax. But nevertheless, in this case, we get typically a very good quantum non-emission performance with close to 99%. We can do also continuous measurements now. And this was on the first generation, typically. And here, it's typically a quantum trajectory where each point is related to an integration time of a signal of 30 nanoseconds. So here, you see, in a single trajectory of a qubit, the evolution of a qubit in the time domain with a resolution time of 30 nanoseconds. So from this kind of measurement, we can also, by making some analysis of all the different histogram statistics, we can obtain a decay which is close to the decay that we have measured by a different way, showing again that the quantum non-demolition of our measurement is quite weak using this cross-care coupling. So only to compare, this was experiment performed in a Yale group with a longitudinal coupling, and they get also quantum dimension, very good in this kind of coupling also. Well, now I think it's time to conclude. Well, we can compare to other project, but maybe it's time is over now, I guess. And so in summary, I would say that we have developed a new kind of readout, which is completely different from the cross-care, from the transverse coupling. So we are no more based by a description using Jens-Cummings Hamiltonians, but we need to develop a new modelization using this particular coupling, which is different. So in this sense, the theory is not yet well developed. And what we have demonstrated in the experiments, that we are able to show very good fidelity using these new techniques, and also quite good performance on quantum non-demolition. So thank you very much for your attention.
Thanks. Questions, Sivan?
Thank you, Olivier, for the very interesting talk. So I have a question. It seems to me that still your coupling has, like, is related to some kind of expansion. Like, this is not like the sigma z times a plus a dagger is still an expansion, right? So how would it change? So does this change? Would it change your analysis of the QND-ness if you would incorporate higher order terms?
No, for sure, in terms of QND-ness, for example, the question is, for example, when we change the photon number inside the cavity, even our coupling are going to deviate to the sample description of sigma z across care coupling because of this photon, when we consider larger photon signal inside the cavity. So, but typically, if you see the perturbation on photon inside the cavity, what is funny is in the Jens-Cummings descriptions, already in the ground, first excited states, if you are empty of photon in the cavity, you have already inducing relaxations. And in our case, due to this coupling, the system is completely not non-relaxation channel for when it is in the ground state, when the cavity has zero or one photon. The system starts to be more complicated when you put more than one photon in the cavity, but it's interesting to probe. Yes.
Okay, thank you.
Other questions?
So, thank you. It's a comment. So, Olivier, is it really honest to quote such numbers when your numbers are actually much better? Because here, you tell the readout is 99 point something fidelity, but it's just due to the relaxation of your qubit. Your readout is, and your QND-ness of your readout are better than the numbers you quote.
Yes, but in some sense, we don't know the source of relaxations.
I know.
So if the source of relaxation is coming from the measurements, it's good to include. If it's a different source,
but
yes.
You can estimate, and you know that it doesn't. So you present numbers that are pessimistic. Your system is better.
Yes. So thank you, Denis. Thank you. I paid him for these questions.
Very nice comment. Other nice comments? Okay, then I think everybody's hungry. So we want to thank the speaker once more.